It's time for the match game. Hollywood Squares Power Whip. From Simon & Simon, Tim Reed. From Gimme a Break, Kari Michelson. Fanny Flagg. Marilyn Michaels. Bruce Vaughn. And the stars of the Match Game Hollywood Squares Hour, Gene Rayburn and John Bauman.
Long guy.
Got a bum arm.
Hello there.
Yahoo!
Thank you.
Thank you.
Here we go.
All right, we've got a lively bunch up there. Are you all lively here?
Yes, that
all
right?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
We're lively. Good time. Ready.
Lively bunch?
Yeah.
Do you feel lively?
I feel very lively, too.
Oh, good, good.
What's been happening lately in your life?
Well, I went to New York last week, had dinner in a neighborhood restaurant. Gee, there's a wonderful neighborhood restaurant. The owner looks like a young Robert Redford.
Can I talk about a hot dog stand and $1,000?
No, I'm sorry. That's impossible. Now we're ready to greet our two players over here, Diana Smith and Anita Gittleson. Thank you. Hello there.
Hi.
Diana.
Yes.
Let's hear about you.
I've been married for 7 years, and
really?
I have two beautiful little boys, Matthew 4 and a half and David 2.
That's it.
And that's, I take my care of my boys all day long. That's
well,
it.
That's
it's
wonderful.
It's busy.
You're a wonderful mother. Hello, Anita.
Hello.
What do you want to tell us?
Oh, I'm a director of development at Long Beach Civic Light Opera, and I have four lovely children, Robert, his lovely wife, Patty, Beverly, and Jerry, and I like to travel and write.
What sort of opera company is that down there?
It's a Civic Light Opera. We do four shows a year.
And
four musical comedies.
Where are they presented?
And operettas.
You mean like the student prints and all that?
Exactly. We're doing Song of Norway next season, as a matter of fact.
Really?
Uh-huh. It's at the Long Beach Convention Center, the Terrace Theater.
Put me on your mailing list.
Okay.
All right. Now, let's start the match game here. We'll play three rounds, and the winner will go on to challenge our returning champion on Hollywood Squares. Chance it went up to $30,000. Diana won the toss. You'll go first.
B, please.
All right. This is it. The movie mogul said. You know what a movie mogul is?
Yes.
Sure.
He said, I never should have filmed my new version of Dracula at Don's Deli. The prop man forgot to bring a wooden stake, so he had to kill Dracula by driving a blank through his heart. Remember how they killed Dracula? They drove a wooden stake in his heart?
Yes.
All right. Well, the prop man forgot to bring a wooden stake, so we had to kill him by driving a blank through his heart. Do you understand? Splendid.
It's a delicatessen question.
Don's Deli. Oh, yeah.
Deli. Favorites.
That's really quite operative here in this question that it, you must remember. It's Don's Deli.
You know, I bought one of those roach motels.
A roach motel?
They don't work. They come in, they make love, they leave, they take those little ashtrays.
Ready, Marilyn? You ready?
Wait, okay. Yes.
Okay, Diana. Movie mogul said I never should have filmed my new version of Dracula at Don's Deli. The prop man forgot to bring a wooden stake, so he had to kill Dracula by driving a blank through his heart.
Salami?
Salami is very good, Diana. Who among you did not say salami?
I don't know. I think I'm going to kill my rep here because I'm starting to match again.
Oh,
here we
yeah.
go, salami.
What got in the boot? By driving a...
See, if you had said rib joint, I'd have been all right. But I said pickle. You know.
Pickle is a good one.
All right.
Pickle is a good one.
That's good.
Anything elongated is all right.
All right, watch
toothpick,
the mob.
Toothpick, pickle, salami, bologna, all that. Kari?
I want to hear some nice cheering.
All right.
All right.
All right, John.
Salami.
Three for Diana. Marilyn?
If I was Edith Bunker, I'd say Archie would drive a salami through his head. Oh, yeah.
Okay. The dingbat has spoken.
Tim and I are from the same part of the country. We don't have... Pickle.
Pickle. Uh-huh. All right. Well, Diana, you did very well with your first round question. Four is quite unusual. Let's see what we have for Anita here. Rocco said, our boys' club was so tough. We didn't have a moose's head on the wall. Instead, we had a blank. You know the way they have stuffed mounted heads on walls of clubs? Well, this is a tough club. We didn't have a moose's head on the wall. Instead, we had a... Ready, Kari? Here we go.
Yeah, okay.
All right. Anita. Rocco said our boys' club was so tough, we didn't have a moose's head on the wall. Instead, we had a blank.
Rhinoceros head.
Don't give up the light opera company business. All right.
Wasn't Rhinoceros Head written by Eugene O'Neill Head?
Yes, yeah. That's right.
All right.
This was a tough club. This was so tough it even made the Godfather look weak. So I went with a cop's head.
Cop's head, of course, a policeman's head. That would be tough, wouldn't it, Tim?
Oh, this is a tough crowd. I had policemen.
Right, there it is. Got two of those so far. Kari?
I'm even tougher than that. I said Hell's Angels head.
The Hell's Angels head. That would be difficult. All right, John?
Yes, it was Eugene Ionesco, but it was very funny. And I said policeman's head.
All right.
I keep getting my Eugenes mixed up.
I know.
Boy, Marilyn.
Hi, I was thinking in more of the MGM, you know, Hollywood Lion's head.
Lion's head is good. Fanny?
Yeah.
This is your second choice, I take it.
Yes.
Really?
I'm almost afraid. Well, they're really mean. A nun's head.
A nun's head?
Whoa, that's a tough crowd.
Wow.
What was your first choice, the one that you said you didn't write down?
Well, I thought, since it was Rocky, I thought it would be a horse's head.
From the same Godfather. The symbol in the Godfather, the novel and the movie. All right. So Diana has four. Anita, you still have to score, but perhaps you will in the second round, which will come along right after this.
Channel 10 on Stir.
Are you ready? Hey, here's that wonderful contest. Some lucky person out there in television land can win $5,000 and a chance to appear on NBC soap opera, as maybe even as an actor or an actress or a piece of scenery or whatever. You're going to have a good time. Now, we've made the selections at random from your postcards, and our home contestant is Mrs. Beverly Ford from Dubuque, Iowa. Let's find out if Mrs. Ford is there. Hello, Beverly.
Yes, Gene.
How are you?
I'm just fine, thank you.
Splendid. Now, just because your name was drawn and for no other reason, you're so lucky, we're going to send you $500. Mm-hmm. That's yours, irrevocably, for sure. Got that? Now, one of our production assistants has already told you the names of all of the stars on today's show. And we're going to ask you to choose one of them now for the head-to-head telephone match. Whom do you choose?
Tim Reed.
Tim. Ready, Tim.
Good all choice. Right. Good choice.
Now, Tim will write his answer.
Count your
money.
And
then I'll get a verbal response for you. So don't give me your answer until I call for it, okay? All right, here it is. Wait a minute. I have to look at the card. Excuse me, I banged the phone with the microphone. Are you still there? Okay, hold on, I gotta look at the card. The card says, Lawn Blank. That's L-A-W-N blank.
Lawn
Blank, yes. Don't say it yet. Think about it. Do you understand it?
Yes.
Okay. In the slot when you're ready, Tim? Tim is ready. You collect the $5,000 and an appearance on an NBC soap opera if you match him. What do you say?
Lawn mower.
The audience thinks you're right. They're cheering and hollering and screaming. Let's find out if you're right. Tim, she says lawn mower will match you for the money. What do you say?
Where is she from?
From Dubuque, Iowa.
They got lawns there and they've got lawn mowers there.
Hey! You're a winner! You're a winner! How do you feel about that? Wait a minute. I couldn't hear you. The audience was so excited for you, and we're all so happy for you. I couldn't hear what your reaction was. How do you feel about winning $5,000 and a chance to appear on an NBC soap opera?
Super
duper.
Yes.
All right, we'll look forward to seeing you on the tube on NBC television. Thank you very much for playing Match Game Hollywood Squares Telephone Match. Bye.
Bye.
There she goes. Bye. Thank you. Now, let's carry on, shall we? We're going to go to round two over here. And since you're ahead, Diana, you have to go first. B?
Please.
All right. This is it. As the frontier doctor bandaged the cowboy's lip, he said, "Boy, I don't care how lonely you get, you were crazy to kiss a blank." Cowboy.
Cowboy
out there in the lone prairie.
You know, Gene,
what?
I believe it was Galileo or Bob who proved by climbing to the top of the Leaning Tower of Pisa that you could drop objects of varying weights off the top and they would fall at the same velocity.
Right.
And I figured what better place than right here at Hollywood Squares to test that theory.
Yeah, because you're up there.
I brought two regular house pillows.
Yeah.
A checked one and a beautiful embroidered unicorn pillow. I thought what I would do is I would drop them both at the same time and see whether they both fall at the same velocity.
Right.
Is that okay?
Yes.
Here we go. I'm going to drop them down there.
Okay.
Here we go.
Well, Galileo can't win them all, can he?
I believe it was Einstein who said.
No, Einstein. What did Einstein say? All right, everybody ready? You got one. You got one.
Yeah.
You ready here?
Yeah.
All right, let's find out. Here.
I don't play, then.
Can I get my balloon back?
What? Diana, as the frontier doctor bandaged a cowboy's lip, he said, "Boy, I don't care how lonely you get, you were crazy to kiss a blink."
Coyote?
Coyote?
Yeah.
Coyote? Maybe?
Not horrible.
One never knows. Tim, what do you say?
Oh, I don't play. Well, it starts with a C, but it's cactus.
Cactus. Yeah. Oh, yeah. All right. Who else plays? Fanny.
I said bull.
Hey, bull.
Yeah.
Right. Anita, you've got a chance to catch up here because she remained at four. Which is not bad. At the ski resort, Wally the wise guy said to Fat Frida, "Lady, you don't need a ski lift. You need a blank." They're at the ski resort. All right. John, all right, John. Anita. At the ski resort, Wally the wise guy said to Fat Frida, he says, "Lady, you don't need a ski lift. You need a blank."
Tow truck.
A tow truck. Tow truck might work. I don't know. Let's find out. What did you say?
Well, I thought I was going to be on the minority on this one, but I went with tow lift.
A tow lift.
Well, tow.
Tow lift, I guess, is definitely.
It's a tow. Yeah, I put lift in there just because it was superfluous.
No, that's not right. Truck is a truck. Tim?
I wanted to say face, but I didn't.
Facelift.
So I said crane.
Crane is good. Crane or Derek or any of those things. Sorry.
Okay, I think she needs a helicopter or a plane to get her up
there. A helicopter. All right. Anita is looking for a tow truck, an unlikely possibility, but I will canvass you anyway.
Well, yes, because there were two ways to interpret this question, and one of them was a ski lift, a facelift kind of thing, but it wouldn't be your face, so I said a tummy tuck. See?
Right. That's good.
Now, you know, I should have said a tummy tuck, because that's what my husband does for a living. He's a surgeon who does a gastric bypass operation on obese people. But I didn't say that. I said a wheelchair instead. I should have said what you said, John, really.
Neither one would match.
Really? Yeah. I don't know how I got this.
We both got booed anyway.
All right, Fanny.
I hate to be booed, however. I said whole body lift.
A whole body lift. Yeah. So there's round two, 4-0. Diana's still ahead. Round three, the last round, right after this. Here we go with the third and final round. Diana, you're ahead. Go first.
Be again, please.
All right. Same two people play, Fanny and Tim. Here it is. Sherlock Holmes says, "Elementary, my dear Watson, elementary. The murderer was a plumber. You see, the victim was blanked to death." murder was a plumber.
Missing
a letter. Give me a clue what it is. You can't.
It's all right. I'll help you with the spelling. Here. That's it. You got it. Okay. All right. Diana. Sherlock Holmes says elementary, my dear Watson. The murderer was a plumber. You see, the victim was blanked to death.
Plunged to death?
Plunged to death. All right. What do you say, Tim? Plumber's talk here.
I went to college, too. Yeah. The best this. I could come up with was drained.
Drained. Yes. You went back to the old spelling.
Oh, no, it didn't. No, I got it right.
You got it right.
Yes, I started out with plumed and quickly switched to plunged.
When she found out the catch. Well, there's one more for her. Now, Anita, this is your last gasp. You ready for it?
Try my best.
Yes. Would you like to do a little aria from Carmen?
I'd love to if I could.
Public domain. No one
can guess. Scratch fever.
Ready? Dumb Dennis is the world's dumbest practical joker. Stay out of show business. He's so dumb, once he tried to short sheet a bed of blank. That's how dumb he is.
A bed of.
He's so dumb. You know what short sheeting is?
What short sheet? I don't even know what that is.
Well,
wait.
When you're in the army. Remember when you were in the army?
Oh, sure.
And you were in the barracks with all those guys, and you went to bed late one night, you got home late.
Yeah.
And you tried to get in the bed, and someone remade your bed so the sheets only came up halfway, and you couldn't put your feet anyplace. That's short sheeting.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Shall I explain?
But I'm doing a great Judy Holliday.
Yes. Thank goodness for Fanny and the bottom tier. All right, Anita.
I'm telling you.
Dumb Dennis is the world's dumbest practical joker. Once he tried to short sheet a bed of blank.
Lettuce?
A bed of lettuce. All right.
I couldn't get that. Okay, never mind.
That's good. There are there are two other good possibilities that I can think of. What do you say?
Well, I hope I've got one of them. Roses.
A bed of roses is one. Now, let's see. You got to match everybody else to stay in the game.
You know, I did say let's cross it out and said roses.
Roses. All right, so that means
roses.
Diana wins the game. What do the rest of you have? Roses, roses, roses. All right, come on down, Diana. Anita, we thank you for being with us. We're going to send some gifts your way from the match game. Anita Gittleson, ladies and gentlemen. There she goes. Hey, champ, how do you feel?
Nervous.
No, I don't think nervous. Take a deep breath. Now, listen, we're going to switch to Hollywood Squares, and here comes the rest of our set. The stars will be out in a moment, and John and I will trade plays. We've got a lot of more excitement coming up. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
A member of our studio audience will receive Gibson's portable dishwasher featuring three levels of washing action, hygiene cycle, forced air drying, and an energy saver switch furnished by Gibson. It's time for more of The Match Game. Hollywood Squares Power Whip. From Cup Factory, Teresa Denzel. From Aftermash, William Christopher. Robert Donner. And taking over, the star of the Hollywood Squares, John Bauman.
All right, we're going to be right back in just a minute to play Hollywood Squares. Be there.
And now, John Bauman and the Hollywood Squares.
Yes, well, you have reason to be excited. You did very, very well, Diana Smith. And you got four on the first round, and then you took the plunge with Fanny on the last round. You pitched a shutout in the match game, and you're moving swiftly onward to Hollywood Squares. Good for you. We have three brand new celebrities with us. Teresa Ganzel, Robert Donner, and William Christopher. And today I think is my day to talk to you, Teresa, because you are on a
relatively brand new NBC program called The Duck Factory.
That's right.
Now, for those who may not have seen it, just tell us what you do on the show.
Well, it all takes place at a cartoon studio, and the Mouse Factory is about Mickey Mouse. This is the Duck Factory because our cartoon character that we make is Dippy Duck. And well, I do not do the voice for Dippy Duck.
You do the voice of Teresa Ganzel, and you do it quite amazingly, I must say.
I play the owner of the studio and the receptionist.
Uh-huh. Well, you know, it really is good to have you here. You have been personable and bubbly and terrific all week, and you make me want to tune into the show. You really, really do. Thanks. Let's you and I zip over here, Diane, and play Hollywood Squares. Here we go. And before we begin today's contest, we will reacquaint ourselves with our defending champ. Her name is Claudia Subcue. Her total in two eventful days of Hollywood Squares play, $39,450. Now, the time has truly come, Claudia, to discuss the psychic elements in your Hollywood Squares play. Has this ever happened to you before?
No.
Okay, for those of you who didn't watch the last two shows, Claudia, someone else did this a long time ago, right when the show's beginning. Claudia picked the 30 twice in a row. Mm-hmm. How do you do it? Is it sheer? You don't want to give up the secret?
You know, just go with what I feel.
Go with the flow.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Go with the flow.
Well, it's quite amazing. The first day she won 30, the second day she won somewhat less, but still won the super match and is very, very happy. Mm-hmm. She's going to play Hollywood Squares at least one more time until she hears the Time's Up bell. We will probably all hear it, and whoever is ahead at that point goes on to play Supermatch, which can be worth up to $30,000. First game's worth $100 plus $25 for every square, and Claudia, you're the champ, so you get to pick a star.
Tim, please.
Tim Reed from Simon & Simon.
Yeah.
You have a dogfish. Can he be taught to roll over, or are you wasting your time?
Well, keeping him in the pool is a hard thing to do, too. No, you can't teach them to roll over.
You can't teach a dogfish to roll over.
No way.
What do you say for the first square, Claudia?
I agree.
You can teach a dogfish to roll over, so you should have disagreed with Tim, and your opponent gets the first square. You can teach a dogfish to roll over. Try it at home.
Now, can you tell us what a dogfish
is?
Beats me.
Okay.
You have to train.
I know we're together here.
This continues with those little bonefish, though.
This does continue your pattern, though, of starting off slow. Diana Smith, your move, pick a star for an O.
Gene, please.
Gene Rayburn. Here we go.
But you can't teach him to go on the paper.
Gene, do most anteaters have teeth? Or do they gum their ants like Gabby Hayes?
They don't have teeth. They reach in there. Their tongue is about this long. Really?
How long is it?
It's about that long. And they stick that tongue into the ant hole and they just slurp them right up, and they don't chew them at all. They go right down.
That's disgusting.
So no teeth.
They're crawling around in there. Oh, it's an awful sight.
Anteaters have no teeth. Agree or disagree, Diana?
I agree.
Anteaters lack teeth. You are right to agree, and you get another square. I didn't know that Gabby Hayes gummed his ants, however. You learn something every day.
Which made his uncles very perturbed.
You are playing X. Pick a star.
William to block.
Okay. You missed this one. The first game goes in a clean sweep to Diana. William Christopher, what serious breach of etiquette did President Reagan commit on his recent trip to China? Did he call Premier Deng Xiaoping my good friend, or did he tip a Chinese shopkeeper?
Well, after my long friendship with our Chinese brothers and being an expert in the Orient, I can say that had he called Mr. Dao Ping his good friend, I think that would have been a serious breach of etiquette, and I'm afraid the president did err in that direction.
He said he called Premier Deng Xiaoping my good friend. What do you say, Claudia, to block?
I agree.
President Reagan tipped a Chinese shopkeeper. No, you should have disagreed with William, who is not an expert at all, and your opponent got that square and won the first game. We will be back to find out what happens in our $200 game after these messages. See you then.
Stay tuned for more of The Match Game, Hollywood Squares. Now back to John Bauman and the Hollywood Squares.
175 for the challenger. Nothing so far for you, Claudia, but as I said before, this has been your pattern of starting slow and charging from behind. You do get to start this game. Pick a star.
Tim, please.
Okay, let's see if this works. According to the Better Vision Institute, can reading a book in dim light really harm your eyes? Or have mothers been lying to us all these years?
Let me see that. Let's see. Dim light. Yeah, I'm still a little steen about dogfish, but I'll go on. Teach a dogfish to write. It'll harm your eyes, reading in dim light. Also okay. In total darkness.
He says reading reading in dim light will, in fact, harm your eyes. What do you say, Claudia?
I agree.
Reading in dim light won't harm your eyes. No, no, you should have disagreed with Tim.
Oh. I'm playing this game under protest. My mother doesn't lie.
Reading in dim light will not harm your eyes, but it can give you a headache. Diana, your move for another O.
Gene, please.
Gene Rayburn. Let's see what happens. According to the old farmer's almanac, if you mix this in water, you will have a fine silver polish. Is it cigarette ashes or popcorn?
Cigarette ashes. Easy.
What do you say, Diana?
I agree.
Cigarette ashes it is. You're right to agree, and you get the square. Yeah. I'm glad they have some use. Claudia, what is happening? Make your move.
William DeBlock.
This comes as no tremendous surprise to me at this point.
Let's hope you know more about this than you did about China. In 1983, Bill, Dr. Robert Levine managed to do something that only two men in history have done before him. Did he perform a successful brain transplant, or did he marry Mary Tyler Moore?
It would be lovely to think that the brain could be transplanted, but I think that's far beyond our capabilities. I think he managed a wedding.
He says, Dr. Robert Levine married Mary Tyler Moore. What do you say to Block, Claudia?
I'll agree.
Dr. Robert Levine married Mary Tyler Moore. Yes. It was a fairly well-publicized event. You're right to agree, and you get the square, and you do block, and you're on the board. Okay, she's broken through Diana and at a pivotal time, but it is your move for an O.
Fanny, please.
Fanny Flagg. You're asleep when a vampire bat flies into your room. When he bites your neck, will the pain wake you up? Or is he so gentle that you won't feel a thing?
Well, this is very esoteric, isn't it? You're talking about the legend of the vampire, aren't you?
We're talking about the legend.
Yeah.
The actual bat.
The bat.
We're talking about the actual real bat.
The real bat. Well, because, you know, different vampires have different techniques. I believe that it's very painful to have been bitten by a bat. I will say it will wake you up.
So the pain will wake you up. Agree or disagree, Diana?
I agree.
If a vampire bat flies into your room when he bites your neck, you won't feel a thing. No, you should have disagreed with Fanny. You will sleep through the whole movie, apparently. We will be right back to complete the $200 game after these messages. Please return with us, understand? $225 for the challenger and $50 for the champ, but we just have had kind of a pivotal question. The vampire flew in and kind of bit Diana, and it's Claudia's move.
Kari to block, or to win.
To win.
To win.
Concentrate now. Kari Michelson.
Yes.
Who blushes more, a teenage girl or her grandmother?
I think grandmothers have done their share of blushing. I'll say a teenage girl.
Okay, she says a teenage girl blushes more than a grandmother. What do you say, Claudia, for the game?
I agree.
A teenage girl blushes more. You're right to agree, you get the square, and you win the second game. What that really means
in the world of Hollywood Squares is that she has followed her pattern once again. 275 she has charged from behind, but it's very, very, very close. 225 for Diana Smith. Sweep the X's and O's off the board. $300 game. Let's keep it moving with you, Diana. Pick a star.
Tim, please.
All right. You're a male spider trying to attract a mate.
Mm-hmm.
Will you offer her a dead fly? Or will you vibrate the strands of your web?
That sounds hip. I like that. Vibrate what now? I may do that as a man. Come on. What is that? I like that. That's nice.
Tim says that male spider will vibrate the strands of his web.
Oh, yeah.
What do
I
you
like
say,
that.
Diana?
I agree.
He will vibrate the strands of his web. Yes. You're right to agree, and you got the first square in this game. So only $25 difference, as close as it can get and not be a tie. Claudia, your move.
Fanny, please.
Fanny Flag. Do penguins have feathers, or are they smooth?
I don't care what anybody says. If a vampire bit me, I would wake up. However, penguins are smooth.
Says penguins are smooth. Agree or disagree, Claudia?
I agree.
Penguins have feathers. You should have disagreed, and your opponent gets that square. So the pendulum has kind of swung back to you, Diana. See if you can make it swing the whole way. Pick your star.
Teresa to win, please.
Okay. This would give you the lead once again. Teresa Ganzel, statistically speaking, who is more likely to remarry? Johnny Carson? Or... or Joanna Carson?
I would say Johnny Carson.
Okay, now what this means really is a man versus a woman. A divorced man versus a divorced woman is the issue here.
Okay, then
I'll stick with that answer?
Then I'll say Joanna Carson. No, I'm just kidding. No, I would say, okay, the thing would be... it would be, definitely, it would be a woman would more likely remarry.
Okay, so she changed her tune. She says a divorced woman is more likely to remarry than a divorced man.
I disagree.
What do you say, Diana, for the game?
I disagree.
It's quite a courageous thing to do at this stage. And in fact, the man is more likely to remarry, and you're right to disagree. You get the square, and you win the game. Good for you. Is good playing. It always takes a little extra to disagree. You have $600, $275 for Claudia, but quick mathematics shows us $400 game coming up. Sweep the O's off of the board, and you can still catch up if you're real efficient. Pick a star, Claudia.
Tim, please.
Tim Reed.
Yes.
Where does an eider duck pluck the feathers for her nest?
Could you try that in English now?
Yes. Where does an eider duck pluck the feathers for her nest?
What kind of duck?
An eider duck.
An eider duck.
You know what I mean.
Silly me.
Sure.
Where does she pluck the feathers?
Yeah, here are two choices. Mm-hmm. From her own breast or from her husband's?
Husband's breast? Oh. I would say from her husband's breast.
Says she plucks the feathers from her husband's breast. What do you say, Claudia?
I'll agree.
She plucks her own breast, and you should have disagreed. So your opponent gets the first square in that game. Diana Smith, pick a star for an O.
Fanny, please.
Fanny, once again. During his term in office, President Andrew Johnson kept something unusual on the lawn of the White House. Was it a herd of Jersey cows or a tent for his in-laws?
Same thing.
Or a herd of in-laws.
What year was this?
Give me an answer here. He was the president right after Lincoln.
Do the joke about the bats.
I want to get this right. I think he went in rather fast, so I think he kept a tent for his relatives.
She says, Andrew Johnson kept a tent for his in-laws on the lawn of the White House. What do you say, Diana?
I disagree.
He kept a herd of Jersey cows on the lawn of the White House, probably to keep it short. Good for you. You are proving to be quite a good player. She's got a mess of O's up there. Claudia, pick a star.
Teresa to block.
Okay, Teresa Ganzel. Does your cat have to be a sexually active cat to enjoy catnip? Or do neutered cats get turned on too?
I think neutered cats cease having any sexual fun. So I think it's that's.
I love the way she talks.
Say the question one more time, and I'll give you the correct answer.
Does your cat have to be sexually active to enjoy catnip, or if he's neutered, can he enjoy catnip as well?
Neutered cats can't enjoy it.
Okay, she says neutered cats cannot. Agree or disagree, Claudia, for a critical block?
I'll agree.
Neutered cats get turned on, too. And you should have disagreed. Your opponent gets that square, and your opponent wins yet another game. And the bell means that time is up. She has indeed done it. Diana Smith, $1,075 new champ. Good for you. Zip your way right over there. Join Gene. Get set for a shot at the big money. And you had 2 days on here that were truly, in every sense of the word, your day. Today wasn't.
No.
You're a great champ. Only the second person in the history of our show to pick the 30 2 days in a row. Her total leaving here, $39,725, accumulated in only 3 days of play for Claudia Subcu. Okay, Gene, take it away.
Whatever the new champ. And we'll be back with her and the stars for a go at the big money right after this.
Here to play the super match is Gene Ravers.
Okay, Rich Jeffries, here we go. You ready?
Yes.
All right, Diana, this is the first trip up here for Diana. She knows that she could win up to $30,000 here. It's an exciting prospect here in the Supermatch. We all wish her well, and let's see what happens. We polled an audience not too long ago and said, write down your best answer to this. Blank oats. Now, if you give the answer they gave most often, it's $1,000, $500 for the second, $250 for the third. Now, let's see what sort of assistance you'll get from the stars here. One at a time, if you please.
John.
Quaker oats.
There's one.
Fanny. Gosh. Quaker oats. Wild oats.
Wild oats.
Yeah.
Right.
William.
Bill, what do you say? Have you got one?
I was kind of running downhill, but I'd say horses oats.
Horses oats.
No, honey, that's horses.
I told you it was downhill.
Chinese oats would have done.
All right, so you have horses oats, wild oats, and Quaker oats. You want one of those or one of your own?
Yes, Quaker oats.
You want Quaker oats?
I hope.
One bowl of Quaker oats, hold the cream. Let's find out if Quaker oats is up there. First, we'll reveal the $250 response. Wild oats. All right, you got that one from Fanny. The $500 response says, Hall and Oates.
That's not how you spell Oates.
I know it. It's O-A-T-E-S, isn't it?
Yes.
That's the way he spells his name. But anyway, it's a singing group. And here's your last chance for Quaker Oates. Slide it, Steve.
Yeah!
$1,000. 1,000 big ones for you. Now for the head-to-head match with any star of your choosing. After you've made your selection, we'll ask the star to reveal a hidden number. And you know what your predecessor did here. Mm-hmm. 2 days in a row, she picked the big one, the 3-0. And that's what you're looking for. Whom do you call on?
John.
You think John has a big number today, eh? He's had it a couple of times. Let's see if he's got it today. 20,000 is what you're playing for. 20,000 ain't bad. 20,000. Good luck to you. Ready, John?
Yes.
Here it is. Soap blank. That's S-O-A-P blank. Soap blank. John's ready, Diana. You collect the $20,000 simply by matching him. What do you put in that blank? Soap.
Opera.
Soap opera. Soap opera is what she says.
We're surrounded by them here at NBC. Another World precedes us. John, she says soap opera will match you for the big dough.
You know, we people who hold down that bastion of television, the game show, have to defend our territory, you know, and these people who are always interested in soap opera, soap opera, soap opera, soap opera, made me say soap opera.
$22,075. Congratulations to you. We'll be back with our champ here and the stars right after this. All right. Now, the champ here, Diana, came close to getting the 30. She got a 20, which is certainly better than taking a 10. But right now, we will find out who has a 30. Ready, set, go. Teresa. Has a big number.
Did
you get anything?
You win 30 ducks. Yes.
Right.
At a factory.
See you tomorrow, stars. You were splendid. Gene Rayburn inviting you to join us tomorrow.
John Bowen saying so long for the Match Game Hollywood Squares Hour. See you then.
A member of our studio audience will receive Venra Citation Super Thin Quartz Watches, yellow gold tone case with black dial and jewel crown, furnished by Venra's Watch Company. Rich Jeffries speaking for the Match Game Hollywood Squares Hour, a Mark Goodson television production.